Hello everyone, to all the new students, welcome to Green Mountain College, and to all the returners, welcome back. I'm Safe Sex Fright.
And I'm Captain Consent. We're here today to talk about one of our favorite topics,
sex.
We brought some friends to help us out.
Although we live in a culture that is obsessed with sex, actually talking about sex can be really hard. When were we ever taught to talk about it? What language do we use? How do we not feel embarrassed?
But really, it is our bodies, it is our lives. It is something that can be fun and empowering and amazing. So why shouldn't we talk about it on our own terms?
And we have to talk about it, because we've all had different relationships and experiences, and something that may be not so big of a deal for one person might be more so for another.
For the next hour and a half, we're going to be talking about consent.
Okay, consent. What does that mean exactly?
Well, everyone defines consent a little bit differently, but it's really about communication and paying attention to the body language. It's about asking permission to make sure both you and your partner feel comfortable and respected, even in the heat of the moment.
Wait, asking during a hookup? What a mood killer.
Mood killer? Listen, if you can't even talk about hooking up with someone you really want to do it with, then you shouldn't be hooking up in the first place anyway.
Why should we practice consent?
There are so many reasons. It's about making sure both you and your partner want to be doing what you're doing, and about making sure everyone has fun and feels safe in their bodies.
It's about making sure you have complete ownership over your own body.
It's about helping to heal from past abuse.
It's about creating a culture defined not by power and coercion, but by communication, mutual support, and understanding.
It's about realizing that we have the power to change our culture, which allows sexual assault to happen again and again. Consent isn't just about sexuality, it's a lifestyle. Practicing an open communication and learning to read body language can enhance any relationship you have, not just romantic ones.
This workshop is as much about being sexual as it is about not being sexual. The point is to find empowerment to do whatever we want with our bodies and feel our best and help our friends do the same.
Most of us, especially those who are socialized as males, have been taught by our media and our culture that our manliness and our worthiness is directly related to whether or not we are getting any. If we accept this reality, it will lead us to situations where we are engaged physically without getting in touch with our desires and our needs. Sex should never be a validation, regardless of our gender identities. When we make judgments based on our sexual behavior, we limit our ability to find what works best for ourselves. Healthy and fulfilling sexual experiences must start with communication. Communication can only start when we get in touch with ourselves.
Keep in mind that the stuff in these skits can happen to anyone, regardless of the gender or gender identities of all parties involved.
So who's putting on this workshop?
So the workshop was created by Consent in Action, a group of students from Prescott College who wanted to see a community committed to respect, honest communication, and consent. We wanted to invite you all to help make this kind of community happen, because students who are drawn to Green Mountain College have a deep drive to change things for the better.
Some of you have probably done a lot of thinking and talking about this kind of stuff, or have been in a lot of relationships, or maybe none at all. But the reason we wanted to have this workshop is because sexual assault happens. There are different manifestations of it, and it isn't even always intentional, but it messes up our community, and the trauma can stick with a person for the rest of their life. It's going to take everyone's help to stop it, and the first thing we can do is start talking about it.
So, this workshop is going to be divided up into two parts. First off, we're going to have a series of fabulous performances to illustrate different situations where consent comes into play. Then we're going to divide up into small groups and talk about what consent means to us.
This topic can be really intense and potentially triggering, so if you need to take a break, step out of the room, we completely understand.
So, without further ado,
let's talk about consent!
Sprite told me that drunk people are much less likely to practice safe sex, meaning a higher risk of STDs or unwanted pregnancies. Let's go on a bike ride tomorrow, then make lunch at my house.
What a great idea.
Well, I'm gonna go home and eat a whole bag of chips. Could I have a hug?
Yeah, see you tomorrow.
Sounds like they're gonna have fun tomorrow.
Consent win!
Aren't you a sexy thing? Why doesn't
and a fox like you have a date.
Oh, thanks.
Are you studying adventure education at Green Mountain College? You look like you could be adventurous. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah. I love rock climbing.
Baby, if I had my chance, I'd scoop a cupcake like you up in a minute.
I guess so.
Why don't we get out of here? I'll take you back to my place, show you my entertainment system.
I guess so. Hey, friend, I'm going to leave with this person I just met. I'll see you tomorrow.
Okay.
Consent fail!
Come on now. Your friend is obviously walking into a bad situation here. It's important to support our friend's autonomous decision making, but it sounds like a perfect time to check in and help your friend make the best decision for themselves, especially when their guard is down, like when their self-esteem is low or when they've been drinking.
Watching out for yourself and your friend doesn't just mean walking down well-lit streets and accompanying someone who's walking home alone, but also being observant of things happening around you and communicating your feelings when you're uncomfortable.
Let's do this again.
Take two.
Why don't we get out of here? Take you back to my place, show you my entertainment system.
I guess so.
Can I talk to you for a second? Do you feel like that person is treating you respectfully?
Yeah, I know, right? Well, sometimes. But I don't know. Isn't that normal? They seem pretty nice.
Well, sometimes normal is messed up. If they were really nice, they'd be less objectifying. You're awesome. So much more than just a hot body. And you deserve to be treated better.
Yeah, I know you're right. Hey, I don't think that the way, I don't like the way you approached me. It was very disrespectful. So you can go play with your entertainment system yourself.
Fine. Whatever.
I just don't seem to realize how verbally objectifying they can be. It's dehumanizing, it creates a climate for harassment and sexual violence.
You're so right. Our words really do have an impact. The more we use phrases like sexy little thing and tell rape jokes, the more numb we become to the reality of what we're actually talking about.
Self-respect win!
If y'all just boobies look like this size, 23 waist, pretty face, deep thighs.
Getting real cozy.
Yeah. I think she's pretty awesome. It just feels kind of weird now because we hooked up that one night, and now she expects the same thing every time we get together. I love hanging out with Jerry. I don't want to confuse her or anything, but I don't want to be hooking up all the time.
It's great you two are building a relationship, but it should be on your own terms. Talk to Jerry about your feelings. Just because you've done something together does not mean you are under any obligation to do it again.
But what if she gets annoyed or bored and wants to break up with me?
Do you really want to be in a relationship where you don't feel like your boundaries are being respected? Bribing and coercion are both forms of sexual abuse. No one is entitled to anyone else's body, not even if you're married.
I guess I didn't think of it that way. It's so important to have supportive friends like you that actually pay attention to what's happening around them and give honest feedback. Thank you so much. Next time, can we plan to check in a few times throughout the night?
Yeah.
So for. Accepting no, take one.
Thanks for coming over. It just seemed like a low-key movie-watching kind of night. You're fun to hang out with. Thanks for making popcorn.
Yeah, of course.
I love this movie. Eating popcorn. Hey, so do you want to hook up?
No, thanks. This is my favorite part of the movie.
Why don't you want me? You're sort of dressed like you want it. Why did you leave me on then? We've hooked up before. Such a tease.
What's wrong with you? Don't give me blue balls.
Come on.
Consent fail!
Oh my goodness, this is breaking my heart. If someone says no, it's not your prerogative to ask them why and definitely never try to change their answer. Maybe it has nothing to do with you. Don't take it personally. Accept and respect their decision. Pressuring and coercion does not equal consent.
You are not entitled to an explanation. Scene 5, take 2.
Hey, so do you want to hook up?
No thanks, this is my favorite part of the movie.
Okay. Wow, the special effects in this movie are awesome!
I know, this is my favorite director.
Consent win!
Everyone's feeling respected,
and nobody has to feel awkward.
Or unsafe, or violated. I met this girl last night.
Last night, I met a guy.
She was such a babe, and seemed like a person who I could relax and have fun with.
He seemed like a really nice guy, not bad to look at. Came off pretty sweet and was cracking hilarious jokes all over the place.
We started talking, vibing all over each other, grinding on the dance floor, having a few shots. It was going pretty well.
We danced for a bit and he bought me a few drinks. I liked the attention. We were getting pretty flirty. He seemed to really like me.
I asked her if she wanted to take a walk and go someplace for a walk. She was so beautiful and I really wanted to make my move.
We went for a walk around the square. We talked about classes and the different field courses we had taken so far. We seemed pretty compatible.
We made small talk and finally arrived at my house. I asked her if she wanted to come in or if she'd rather I took her home. She came in. I could tell she wanted me.
After a little while, we ended up at his house. He invited me inside, but when I seemed a bit hesitant, he offered me a ride home. I really liked him and I didn't want to just leave yet. I thought it would be better to sober up a little first, so I came inside for a glass of water.
One thing led to another, and we ended up making out on the couch.
We listened to some music on his laptop and talked some before he leaned over and kissed me.
She was such a good kisser. I mean, we have great chemistry. She let me feel her up, and I knew it was just going to get better.
At first, I was really enjoying the kissing. It was really sweet. I liked it. But then, it kind of got uncomfortable. He started putting his hands all over me. It was moving really fast.
Things were going so well. I had this super pretty girl in my house, and we were hooking up on my couch. We started taking off our clothes. I was loving it. Luckily, I had a condom in my pocket, so I was ready right away.
I didn't really know what to do. I really liked the guy, and he seemed to like me. I didn't want him to think I was being a tease, but I don't think I was ready to have sex with him. He just kept taking my clothes off. I was kind of afraid of what he'd think if I stopped him. I didn't think it was going to go so far. We had been drinking and it happened so fast. At least he used a condom.
I drove her home in the morning in kind of a daze. We were both kind of tired from the night before.
When it was over, I didn't really know what to do or say. He kept telling me I was beautiful, so I guess that's good, right? It was kind of a long, quiet ride home. I felt awkward that things went so far.
I had so much fun. I think we both had a good time.
It's weird. I feel kind of violated. I probably should have said something. I just didn't think it would happen like that.
Yeah, it was totally consensual. I mean, she didn't say no, right?
I mean, it wasn't like he raped me. But if he had asked me or checked in, the night would have turned out differently. I guess it was consensual, wasn't it?
We live in a society where 1 in 4 women and 1 in 6 men will be sexually assaulted in their lifetime. I suspect this is connected to the fact that society doesn't necessarily teach us to communicate clearly or look out for each other. Sex is awesome, but for many people it's a big deal. Sharing your body with another person is a pretty intense thing to do, and it can bring up some strong emotions. It is important to remember that no one can really be sure if they have ever been a sexual perpetrator unless they communicate consent every time. You never know when someone's feeling violated unless you ask. It's everyone's responsibility to check in, speak up, and make sure people who we interact with feel empowered and comfortable.
friend shares their story about surviving sexual assault, the most important thing you can do is listen. Allow them the respect to process their own at their own pace, and only share what they want with who they want and when they want to share. Always believe them. Never justify or defend the perpetrator's actions. Don't blame them or tell them how to feel. Be sure to be patient, and let them know that you are there for them if they need support. Let them tell you how to help. A survivor should know that our counselors in the student life and student life are always available to confidently talk about what they're going through and explore options for choosing an active response, anywhere from personal healing to meditation or arbitration.
Sexual assault does not happen to the reported 2,400 plus people in a year in this country in isolated, unrelated instances. Rape is a systematic problem in our culture, perpetuated by the norms of how we regard and treat each other. By learning to effectively support survivors of sexual assault, we begin to end the silence caused by fear and shame. When people feel safer to speak about their experiences, it promotes healing and raises awareness about the serious problem of sexual assault.
People can become really defensive of themselves or their friends in a situation where someone has made a mistake and might get called out for it. It's hard to imagine how to move forward when someone has been hurt. No one wants to get in trouble, there's often poor communication, and no one wants to feel at fault. These situations can be very complicated and emotionally charged. We have to understand that our actions and responses to boundary violations have huge reverberating effects on our community in terms of setting social norms. When we blame, shame, or silence survivors, it breeds fear and disempowers our ability to hold people accountable for their hurtful behavior. Acknowledging a breach of consent does not have to mean branding someone as a predator forever, but it will create an opportunity for them to learn from their mistakes, support the survivor's healing, and send a message about safe and respectful culture that we want to create here. When a perpetrator is willing to be accountable, they can begin the work to restore trust and credibility in our community.
We've said it before, we live in a culture that accepts sexual coercion and assault as normal, thus maintaining conditions for sexual violence. We can change this. So here are a few things we all need to do in order to stop sexual violence from ever happening again. We need to be aware of our language and how it can foster a culture of domination over one another. We can be intentional about the words we use. We can stop making and stop laughing at discriminatory jokes. Support survivors of sexual assault. Hold perpetrators accountable. Start talking with women about how the risk of rape affects their day-to-day life. Talk with men about how the risk of rape affects their day-to-day life. Talk with men about have dialogues with men about how it feels to be viewed as a potential rapist. Learn how sexual violence affects the lives of lesbian, gay, bisexual, transgender, and queer people. We need to realize that all forms of oppression feed off one another and help all people feel empowered. We need to learn to respect ourselves and each other by communicating honestly and openly, which means we always have to ask for consent.
Trigger warning. This skit contains a lot of bullshit excuses that our culture uses to justify sexual violence. We include them here because we want to highlight the fact that they are bullshit. If you have come forward about sexual violence in your own life, or supported someone who has, you are probably very familiar with these victim-blaming antics. If you need to peace out, it's okay.
Have you heard the news about Joe?
No, what's up? Jesse just went to the dean. She says that Joe raped her.
What? Seriously? Joe's one of my best friends. He'd never do anything like that. Plus, they've been dating for a few months. What kind of partner doesn't put out after a few months?
I don't know, but it looks like Joe might get expelled.
Seriously? This could ruin his whole life. He's doing that awesome senior project with rainwater in Kenya. How could Jesse be so selfish? A whole village might not get water because of her. Everyone's gonna be pissed. He's such an important person on our campus. Plus, she always dressed like she wants to get some action. And you should see the way she flirts. No one's gonna believe her.
I guess you're right. She's probably not telling the truth.
Community accountability fail!
I'm sure many of you had this experience in high school or college. someone comes forward saying they've been assaulted, and the students or school administration make life miserable for them, and the perpetrator never has to face consequences. We understand that situations aren't always clear-cut, but it's important to give the survivor the benefit of the doubt. Not many people lie about sexual assault. With the way that our culture treats survivors, very few people would choose to go through that process if they weren't telling the truth. These situations can be incredibly difficult, especially if you are close to either party. But supporting survivors of sexual assault is an essential component in ending the perpetual cycle of power and violence that is normalized in our society. Rewind. Have you heard the news about Joe?
No, what's up?
Jesse just went to the dean. She says that Joe raped her.
What? Seriously? Joe's one of my best friends. He'd never do something like that. Plus, they've been dating for a few months. What kind of partner does he put out after a few months?
There are a lot of reasons why people choose not to be sexual or take their time with sexuality. That's no excuse. Rape is rape, whether you've never met the person or you've been married for 50 years.
Okay, so I guess that was kind of a messed up assumption, but seriously, this could ruin Joe's whole life. He's doing that amazing project with rainwater in Kenya. How could Jesse be so selfish? A whole village might not get water because of him. Everyone's gonna be pissed. He's such an important person on our campus.
No matter how much Joe has accomplished, it does not take away from the fact that he may have raped somebody. If he did rape her, he needs to be held accountable. We can't praise him for good work he's done while ignoring a crime he may have committed.
But she always dresses like she wants to get some action. And you should see the way she flirts. No one's gonna believe her.
Don't go making assumptions or spreading around rumors. They aren't productive and they just hurt everyone involved. We have to give Jesse the benefit of the doubt. She really needs our support right now.
But how can he do that? He's one of my best friends.
You can't keep making excuses for him. Giving him the support, blind support, doesn't solve anything. And if he did commit rape, and he's willing to take responsibility for his actions, you could really be instrumental in helping him heal from his abusive behavior by holding him accountable for what he's done.
We'll go check on Jessie and make sure she's okay.
Yeah, I think it's time this conversation to end. I don't want this to turn into gossip. Right now, the situation is between Jesse and Joe. We should only get involved if they will ask us to.
It is normal to be defensive in tough situations like these. No one wants to believe that their friend is capable of something as horrible as sexual abuse. But the fact is that these things do happen. If we want to create a safe community, we have to just be honest about our consent fails just as well as our consent wins.
And if we want to create a world where sexual assault doesn't happen, we have to honor survivors. We can't minimize their experiences, no matter how much society encourages us to.
This is a pretty uncomfortable place to end the skit. The group of friends responded in an appropriate way, but what happens next? Whatever happens will greatly affect the lives of all parties involved. College and university resource centers, such as women's and men's groups, counseling, and human resources can often help with these difficult questions. However, you cannot completely depend on your university to do the right thing. There is a newer concept called transformative justice, in which the survivor of assault and the perpetrator participate in mediated meetings. The survivor creates a list of things that they need in order to feel safe in their community, and the perpetrator works on their own process of changing their behavior in a supportive community. Restorative justice can be an incredibly taxing and intense process and cannot be taken lightly. If a group of you are truly interested in committing yourself to studying and practicing restorative justice, resources are available online, and you can talk to staff members of the Wellness Center to see if we can make these resources available on our campus.
And now, a song.
Yes.
Thank you.